Today I'm going to be reviewing the Synology DS923 Plus. This is a premium 4-bay NAS from Synology that's targeted towards advanced home users or small businesses, and in this video I'm going to be going over all the hardware inside that makes it work, as well as the software experience and other thoughts I had after using this unit. As a disclaimer, this unit as well as some of the accessories were provided to me by Synology for the purpose of this review, and they also have their Prime Day sales coming up, of which I'll put details on the screen right now. I will also hopefully have my own affiliate links in the video description, which a small cut of that purchase will go towards supporting me and my channel if you end up buying one of these units. But with that out of the way, let's get into the review of this unit. This unit is Synology's highest end 4-bay desktop NAS, and is suited towards more of a business user environment after using it for a bit rather than kind of a home media server. And some things that make me say that is the inclusion of built-in ECC memory, but not having an HDMI output port and relatively poor transcoding capabilities. It's still fine as a media server, but I'm going to probably be looking at this more from kind of a small business perspective or trying to run other apps rather than from a media server perspective thought. But hardware-wise, this system is a compact NAS and about as small as you can get for a 4-bay NAS, and is relatively unintrusive, taking up a fairly small amount of space with a reasonably small power brick and relatively low amounts of operating noise. It's audible in short distances, and you can hear hard drive seek noises a bit with some drives, but I'd say it's generally not bad and blends into the environment of most rooms. Taking a look at the front of the system, we can see the four hot swap hard drive bays, all of which are toolless and pretty good hard drive bays, I'd say. Inside some of these bays, I have the Synology HAT3310 drives. Synology provided me with these 12TB drives for the purpose of this review. And overall, these are pretty nice 12TB drives with no complaints. They're helium-filled drives, appear to be OEM'd by Toshiba, have quite good performance. They also work just fine in any non-Synology products, so you don't have to worry about these not being able to be reused later on. And overall are great drives. Synology lists a few benefits if you're using them in a Synology NAS unit, like automatic firmware updates and better monitoring. But if you're using this in a business environment, I think there's a decent argument to getting a drive that is kind of more guaranteed to work and less likely to run into issues or support problems. And while normal hard drives work just fine in a Synology NAS, and even non-certified drives that I had randomly laying around work plugged and play in the system with only a minor error message saying that they aren't certified before starting the array, these drives are kind of the certified and recommended drives, which if you're trying to argue this to your boss in a business, can make a good amount of sense and probably has less of a chance of any possible issues compared to other drives. Gonna get more into these kind of businessy compatibility arguments later on in this review because I think this unit does kind of bring up that argument a little bit. Moving on to the rest of the front panel, there's a power button, USB 3 port, and some indicator LEDs for the drive and operation. Moving over to the back of the unit, there's two standard 92mm fans that exhaust the hot air from the unit and overall ran pretty quiet in my use. The hard drive seek noise could be a little bit louder than these fans if you're pushing it hard, and definitely depends on the specific hard drives you're using, but generally not an issue in most rooms and blends into the background noise. Moving on to the I/O on the system, we have another USB 3 port, a power connector, 2 gigabit Ethernet ports as well built in. I also had the add-in 10 gigabit network card. This is a little PCIe network card that plugs into this unit and gives it the capability of having 10 gigabit. Synology kind of had this as you have an option for 10 gigabit, but it's not built in. And I'll definitely say compared to other units on the market, I would have loved to see at least 2.5 or 5 gig built into this unit. But having an option for 10 gig is almost mandatory these days at this price point of this unit. Moving over to the bottom of the unit, there's two M.2 slots that are completely toolless for 2280 drives only. There's no way to put smaller drives in and only work with NVMe drives in this system. It appears these drives are Gen 3x2, so you get a maximum of 2 gigabytes per second out of these drives, but with the network connections that you can put on this system, it's unlikely that's going to be a limitation in almost any workload. The one other easily user serviceable part in this unit is the memory, which is available after taking off all the hard drives, and you can see those two SODIMM slots inside. By default, it comes with one 4 gigabyte ACC SODIMM slot, and you can put up to 32 gigs. I, for testing VMs and stuff, got dual 8 gig SODIMMs for 16 gigabytes of RAM with ECC support. I did test some random laptop DDR4 SODIMMs without ECC, and those did work just fine, so that is another option. I also opened this unit up. After taking off a few more screws, I was able to completely take this unit apart and view all the boards inside. There's three main circuit boards, one for the backplane of all the drives, one for the M.2 slots and real 10 gigabit network card expansion slot, and one board that contained the processor, RAM, and a lot of the other components on this system. The processor was a little bit interesting to me in the system, as I've never worked with anything quite like it. It's a Ryzen embedded R1600. Even though the CPU shares the same number as the Ryzen 5 1600, it's a completely different processor though. It is a low power Ryzen embedded processor that's a 2-core, 4-thread chip. It has a clock speed of about 2.6 to 3.1 gigahertz depending on the exact load, and is optimized for applications kind of like this with a relatively low amount of power draw, ECC support, and no built-in iGPU needed. And I wanted to do a little bit of performance comparisons and playing with this CPU to see how well it would hold up against what I consider to be a relatively similar Intel CPU, the N100. This CPU is a dual core 4-thread, whereas the N100 is a quad core, and from what I can see, they're relatively similar in terms of power class and cost. And it seemed like this CPU was a little bit faster in single-threaded workloads, but the N100 was a good amount faster in multi-core workloads thanks to having four real cores. I ran a few benchmarks I'm going to show on screen, some with the utilities included on the included OS, whereas some were running in a VM, given all access to all the cores on both the N100 and this system. I might have been a little bit more hopeful seeing the system had a Ryzen chip built into it compared to the actual performance I saw. I would have loved to see a bit more performance, but a low-power dual-core can only do so much. iGPU-wise, this CPU unfortunately doesn't seem to have an iGPU that can do any hardware-based transcoding on this system. So if you're using Plex or other programs that might want to do media transcoding, all of it's going to run on the main CPU compute cores on this system. And taking a look at the Plex wiki for encoding performance confirmed about the same results that I got, which is 1080p transcoding is typically doable, but 4K is probably not going to work at all on the CPU or be very sluggish. I generally think that you probably don't want to be doing much transcoding on this system, and some of the other options on the market that do have Intel CPUs with QuickSync or even AMD CPUs that have it enabled would likely be a better option if that's something that you need for your workload. CPU cooling-wise, this system seems to use the side intake vents and the main fan to keep it cool, and I didn't run into any CPU cooling or performance issues. Hard drive and M.2 cooling was also relatively good, with drives under moderate workloads being in the 30 degrees Celsius, and the SSDs getting to the 40s or maybe 50s under sustained load, all of which appeared to be reasonable temperatures in my use. Power consumption-wise on the system, with four mechanical hard drives as well as two M.2 SSDs, went between about 30 watts to about 55 watts when maxing out the processor. Under idle, it would be near 30, and it would kind of go up if I was doing multiple backup jobs or running VMs with heavy CPU load on it. This is relatively comparable to other higher-end processor-capable 4-bay NAS units on the market. Software-wise, this unit comes with Synology's DSM OS, which I think is reasonable to call the gold standard or close to it for NAS operating systems. As shown by the amount of people who want to get this OS running on their own hardware, this is definitely part of the selling features of a NAS like this. And after using this OS, I can confirm that it works well in my experience, doesn't appear to have many weird quirks or oddities, and really checks all of the boxes for what you could want in a NAS OS. Starting off with the interface, it has a very kind of pre-built NAS-like interface with kind of a desktop-like experience. Many different apps available for it where you can open them, kind of a desktop, and different windows you can open and move around. Starting off with the drive and RAID configuration this system uses mostly Linux technologies when it comes to managing storage. The Linux Synology has their SHR RAID, which is relatively flexible when it comes to mixing different drive sizes and getting the full capacity from these different drives. Under the hood, this is just using Linux MDADM RAID and multiple different arrays combined with LVM. Then there's optional caching built upon it, which does a relatively good experience at getting better performance with the SSDs handling random I.O. and the sequential I.O. being handled by the spinning drives. Here's a quick benchmark I ran within a drive running on a SHR array of these kind of weird different sized drives I had, as well as being cached by the SSDs. The sequential performance isn't that great, as it's likely leaving all the sequential to the spinning drives itself, but the random I/O performance is pretty good and a lot better than I'd expect out of mechanical hard drives. I don't have a good SSD cache benchmark yet. I'm kind of working on some ideas for maybe making one in the future, but under quick use, it appears to work quite well at speeding up mechanical hard drives on the system. You can also use the SSDs in the system as individual drive bays in their own pool if you want. The one unfortunate thing is it seems like Synology changed how their SSD caching works under the hood. So it's not using, from what I can tell, standard DM or LVM caching inside of Linux, and it's using their own technologies. It likely is working better performance-wise, but what this means is you can't easily mount a Synology SSD cached array on a standard Linux system. Going back in the storage manager, which allows you to mess with those arrays and see the different technologies, I can see which drive bays are being used, see information about it, seeing that they're being used as a cache, view temperatures and status of all my drives easily, and it's a relatively easy to use experience without any issues or notable that seems odd working with the drive array configuration, and handles all the standard setups without problems. And kind of DSM does check all the boxes. You have the standard Samba and NFS shares. You can also do iSCSI shares on this system. Taking a look in the Synology App Store, we can see the available apps you can install on this system easily. Synology has many of their own apps, and then there's some open source programs that are easy to set up and use on here with their App Store, as well as some community programs. The community program list is relatively limited, I'd say, because it doesn't have things like Jellyfin, but you can use a VM if you really want some of those additional programs. I think part of Synology's big selling feature is their apps they make. And I think something like Synology's backup program, as an example, is better on par with a lot of the free or open source solutions I've seen and relatively simple to work with and use on this system. And I think that's kind of part of the selling point of this unit. While it might not be the fastest or most featureful for the price, compared to other backup software that you could pay for, it's pretty seamless, easy to use, and you can sync with other Synology units if you want to get more of these things. And I think there's kind of an argument for how much is the included software worth on this system. Compared to something like Veeam that I've used in my work environments, this system is, I'd say, missing some features and the more obscure things that Veeam supports, but this system's a lot cheaper than some Veeam licenses I've paid for, so it's hard to argue with the value proposition of this unit. The other app I played with a good amount is the Synology virtualization system, which can easily run a virtual machine or two on this system, connect to them in browser, and I think it's using Linux KVM and commute under the hood, has all the similar kind of features, disk types, and something as something like Proxmox would, or almost every other kind of basic Linux-based hypervisor solution, and overall works pretty well. The only thing I'd really wish they'd change is by default use the UEFI instead of BIOS these days, but other than that, pretty painless, most of the options you'd want, but not as many options as VMware, Hyper-V, or Proxmox, the full-blown hypervisors features-wise. Most users aren't going to touch all of those features, and this solution is good enough and comes at a relatively good price depending on how you value it compared to the rest of the unit. And this leads me to the conclusion of this review. This system is a nice, well-rounded piece of hardware, does everything it says it has, ECC RAM is really nice to see included on this system, but doesn't have the most features in any specific way. You can get systems with faster processors, more I/O, better transcoding capabilities for the price, but Synology kind of has the hard-to-value, what I'd consider to be the least likely to have your boss call you in the middle of the night because it stopped working award. And it's really hard to assign a value to that because this system could, like any other system, fail because of some error at the middle of the night and a small name brand wouldn't. But this system seems to be a well-regarded brand. They've had a pretty decent history of making units, a nice piece of software included with it, and going with the supported drives is probably meaning you're going to have less likely to have issues or compatibility concerns using them. It's always hard to assign value to something like this, but I most certainly in my IT career have gone with options that I know aren't the fastest, the best performing or best value because I want to go with the safe option as the least likely to cause problems and probably going to be known by the next guy coming in who wants to work with it. And I think this system fits a pretty good niche where you have a small business where you don't want to get full-on server equipment, you don't want to pay for a cloud provider, and this system's apps are more than good enough for a lot of late users, don't have the most features, but also if you look at the cost, you can't expect the most features for the relatively low price point compared to large enterprise backup software, VM software, or other features. And while it's always hard to value those features, and I know there's definitely viewers who want to be tweakers and want to get the most out of old hardware or optimize it or get the obscure thing that they can get super cheap and get super good performance for, this is not a system for you, but I think it's interesting to kind of look at just the stable classic system. As a quick summary, I think the things that were done really well on this system include the built-in ECC memory is one of my big features, as well as the OS and software is probably the best for these pre-built NAS units. I would have loved to see better networking included in this unit. I think the 10 gig option is almost a necessity at this price point, but with a card that can go in and out, I would have loved to actually see more options like SFP Plus or 25 gig or potentially other standards. If you're going to give me an option card, why not give me a couple more options when you're at it? And in a later release, I would have loved to see something like a Zen 4 or Zen 5 chip that should be more efficient as well as faster for hopefully a similar price point. And perhaps transcoding capabilities. While not needed by everyone, hopefully the IGPs could be utilized if the die has space on it to use those. Let me know what you think of this review in the comments below, as I'd kind of be curious what you guys think of kind of the safe business option compared to the more tweaky, optimized, get the most you can for your money options. Thanks for watching.